Okay, we're going to talk about the arrangement of electrons. Remember, in a previous discussion, I may have mentioned that atoms were kind of like onions. There's layers in them, and there are differing amount of electrons in these layers. So we're going to talk about how the electrons are organized in atoms. The wrong thing there. Okay, so not long ago, and maybe it was long ago relative to your and even my lifetime, they found out that these atoms were loaded up with electrons, and they tried to zap them with other electrons and other particles to see if they could knock electrons out. And they found out that some electrons had roughly the same amount of energy, and other electrons had different amount of energy. And they put all this information together and started assigning locations to them based on the amount of energy it took to knock electrons out. On top of that, they started thinking about the properties of electrons. You might be familiar with the idea that light behaves as both a wave and a particle. And for very small things like electrons, they also have wave and particle properties. And they came up with mathematical descriptions of how these things move about inside atoms and came up with these pictures of what these orbitals look like. There are S-type orbitals. So let's see if I can get up my laser pointer again. So these are my S-type orbitals. The S literally stands for spherical, so when they did the math on these, they found that they kind of obeyed kind of a spherical region of probability around the nucleus. And then after that, I don't know, these were called principal shape or P shape. They are imagined, at least in terms of Cartesian coordinates, to occupy the X, Y, and Z axes. And added together, they also come up with roughly a spherical arrangement about the nucleus. D orbitals are even more exotic. They are, generally, I say, cloverleaf kind of shaped, or if you tied four party balloons together and kind of held them flat, that's what they'd look like. And then there's one oddball in there where it looks like a P orbital with a hula hoop or a donut around its waist. And we're not going to worry a whole lot about this. One thing within any shell, there's only one S electron. In the second shell is where we start seeing P electrons, and there are three arrangements of P electrons. So each orbital can hold two electrons. So my 2s orbital can hold two electrons. My 2p that's arranged along the x-axis can hold on to two electrons. The same for the py and same for the pz. The d orbitals also hold on to two electrons in a funnier shape, so they kind of, I always imagine them kind of swirling around the nucleus. And I can fit two electrons into each of the five separate d orbitals. So a grand total of 10 electrons can go into the d shell. So that a collection of orbitals that have roughly the same energy are referred to as a shell or a subshell. Well, if they all have the same energy, so let's see, if I went all the way out to my third shell, there are 3s electrons. These are the 2p's, but there are also similar orbitals in the third shell, so there are 3p orbitals, and there are my 3d orbitals. And these would represent a shell. The d's represent what we call the d subshell. The P's represent a P subshell, and then the S is my S subshell. They're all parts of the same shell, so sometimes we'll use terms shells and subshells. And then an individual container for two electrons would be called an orbital. So any one of these pictures is an orbital. So in terms of the energy layout, I go through the shells are, all orbitals with the same principal quantum number. So in the first shell, there's only an S type of orbital. In the second shell, there are S and P. Then we get out to the third shell, there's SPD. And then all the way out in the fourth shell, we've got SPD and F. Technically, if we got out into the fifth shell, there would be S, P, D, F, and there would be G orbitals as well out there, a G subshell. A subshell is just the same shape or same relative shape, same angular momentum quantum number. Orbitals are a single region that can hold a maximum of 2 electrons. So an individual p orbital oriented in one of its three possible directions is what we would call an orbital. So if I just have an atom with a single electron, then there's no real reason why any of these orbitals would have differing amounts of energies. So I've got a first shell, so if I have a hydrogen atom, it's got one electron, and that one electron can occupy the 1s orbital. Or if we excite it either thermally or we can shine light on it, then maybe the electron moves up to a higher energy level. And it wouldn't matter because all of these orbitals are the same energy. So there's no way of differentiating them for a single electron model. So as soon as I have more than one electron, these electrons create repulsions between one another, and these orbitals start to spread out a little bit. And so for anything beyond hydrogen, this is how the arrangements of electrons would look. And when we fill electrons into an atom, we always begin at the bottom, the lowest energy, and then we just start filling electrons in this order here. And no one can ever remember it based on this picture here, but this is the order of orbital filling from the lowest to the highest energy. These regions, the s orbitals, the p orbitals, d orbitals, and even the f orbitals correspond to regions on the periodic table as well. Okay, so here's our friend, the periodic table. I've removed all of the element symbols from it. And I'm going to point out the first two columns represent my s filling elements. Helium is also over here, and it is an element that only has an s orbital. Over on the right hand side, I've got my p orbitals, and then down in the middle here, I've got my d orbitals, and then my f orbitals. Literally, if I could get a scissors, I could cut the periodic table kind of like right here and insert my f orbital filling elements in there and have a really, funky wide periodic table. If you want, you can look that up, alternate periodic table arrangements, and you can see a periodic table that looks like that on the web. We very rarely will deal with the elements down in the f block, so we don't really even need, we can kind of almost forget about those secretly. Okay, so what else do I want to say? Remember we referred to the rows on the periodic table as periods. So in the first period, second period, third period. So you see that the numbering of my s orbitals corresponds very well with my periods. The d orbitals get a little bit out of sync with this because remember when we have multi-electron elements, they start to spread out. And it turns out that that third shell starts to overlap with the fourth shell starts to overlap with the fifth shell, and it gets kind of crazy when you get a few layers out in the periodic table. The p orbitals also will follow our period numbering, so second period, third period, fourth period, fifth period, sixth period, so for my p orbital filling elements. Okay, so one of the tasks that we need to be able to do is to determine the arrangement of electrons for any given element. And I've kind of picked out some random elements in a series of slides here. So I've picked out nitrogen. And if you consult a periodic table that actually has the element symbols on there, nitrogen is right here on the periodic table. And what we basically do, or what I recommend students do, is identify where this is going to end up. So this is the last area that's going to be filled by electrons is my 2p area of the periodic table. So I usually tell students to write down that last 2p orbital. And then we're going to treat this just like a game board. So I always say this is like a chutes and ladders game. We're going to start right at the beginning in box number one and go to box number two, and then three, four, five, six, seven, until I end up at nitrogen. So I'm going to describe the areas of the periodic table that I just went through. I think I've done this right. So I started out in the 1s for hydrogen and helium, and then I'm going to move on to the 2s area. So the 2s is next. And then I end up in the 2p area. So that was my last orbital, so I can squeeze all of this together, which I think I do here. And then the next thing I want to do is to figure out how many electrons to put in each of these areas. S orbital, all the orbitals except for the last one. The last one may or may not be filled. All the others will be filled. And if you remember our quick discussion earlier, S orbitals are filled when they have two electrons. So my 1s orbital is going to have two electrons. My 2s orbital is going to have two electrons. I think I've got that kind of laid out here. And we write the number of electrons as superscripts. So we could say that the electron arrangement so far is 1s2, 2s2. And then we need to figure out how many electrons are in the p orbital or p subshell. So I'm going to start here and count over one, two, three boxes. So I've gone three hops over here. So that means that there are three electrons in that 2p subshell. So 2p3. So the full electron configuration for nitrogen is 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. Okay, let's go with chlorine. Chlorine is a little bit further down the periodic table, so we're going to involve more subshells at this point. So we're going to begin at at the end. So I'm going to end up in the 3p area of the table. And before I get to the 3p area, I have to start at the beginning. So I'm going to go through the 1s's. Then I'm going to go through the 2s's, the 2p's, loop back over the 3s's, and then I'm going to end up in the 3p's. And I jumped right to it. And in the 3p area, when I count, I start right here, one, two, three, four, five boxes over. That's why that last p orbital has five electrons. As I mentioned, when I'm filling these in, S's previous to that are going to all get two electrons. Oops, this P here, I must have been just in a zone here. This should be a six, so let's see. Okay, I fixed that. So we've now got six electrons there. One thing I'm going to say is that if we want to verify that we have the right superscripts there, if I go 2 plus 2 plus 6, that's 10, plus two more, 12, plus five more, 17, and compare that to the atomic number for chlorine, its atomic number is 17, so that works out for chlorine. Okay, hopefully I haven't made any other mistakes here. At least I caught that mistake. Okay, let's go with barium. So barium is going to stop way down in the 6s area of the periodic table. So to get there, I've got to go through the 1s's, the 2s's, the 2p's, 3s's, 3p's, 4s's, 3d's, 4p's, 5s's, 4d's, and 5p's, and then I'm going to stop in the 6s's. So I've got to write all of those orbitals down, remembering that all of the s's, their superscripts are going to be 2. All of the full p's are going to have 6 electrons. All of the d's that we've crossed are going to have 10 electrons, and then it's just this last set of orbital, or this last orbital that I have to figure out. So I count over one, two, so that's going to have two as well. So the electron configuration, so 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d10, 4p6, 5s2, 4d10, 5p6, and 6s2. So I didn't make any mistakes here, but I made it on an easier element. Okay, that would get to be a hand cramper after a while. So scientists have devised a way of doing a shorthand for that for the really big electron configurations. We just basically go to the previous noble gas. In this case, the noble gas, just if I back up from barium, so I go back, count backwards until I get to the previous noble gas, that would be xenon. And xenon is what I use to represent everything all the way up through 5p, and then I just write what is in the next shell beyond that, and that would be my 6s2. Let's see, what do I have here? I've got iron, and iron ends up in my 3D, and it's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 boxes over. All of the other orbitals I've crossed in getting there, the 1s, the 2s, the 2p, the 3s, the 3p, the 4s, and then I got to the 3D. All of the previous orbitals are going to be filled. It's that last one that's going to have 6 electrons in it. So when I write that out, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, and then 3p6. Or if we were really lazy, we could say, let's see, this is helium, neon, and then argon. I could say that this was argon, 4s2, 3d6.